After Radiohead released the album In Rainbows back in like 2007, on their website, they put up the song Nude, one of the songs on their album. And I think what they did was, the details might be a little off, but what they essentially did was they posted all of the basic tracks, the vocal track, the drum track, the drum track. And then they also put up a little toggle or instrument you could use if you didn't have your own like Audacity or something. And they encourage people to make their own remix of Nude using the basic tracks. And then after you did your own remix, if you shared it with Radiohead, they would post it on their own webpage, or they had another webpage where they posted all these hundreds and hundreds of remixes of their own song. After listening to Lumpy Money, number 9, the album I'm going to review, I wish, and I don't think it's too late, but Lumpy Gravy, that music, that album, that whatever it is Lumpy Gravy is, because at this point in time, I'm not sure, that should be offered up to the world as something producers, musicians, artists can take and like use as sort of a mold of a pound of clay, mashed potatoes, and Close Encounters of the Third Kind, maybe a sourdough starter to make your own. I mean, Danger Mouse, Brian Eno, Robert Fripp, James Murphy. What if these people took this music and did their own thing with it and then gave it back to the world? That's what should happen with Lumpy Gravy. And I will tell you why later in this video. Okay, we're on. Hello, my name is Shaggy. Thank you for watching. I am the Opinionated Hippie, currently ranking and reviewing every single Frank Zappa album released after he passed away in December of 1993. And out of the 55 released, I am currently on number 9, Lumpy Money. This is a 3-CD set that is essentially, it was released in 2009. I think this is the second of the Project Object series. And that is a series of releases that looks in depth at particular releases. So we had Mofo, which looked at Freak Out. We had the Cruisin' and the Jets, Ruben and the Jets, Cruisin' with Ruben and the Jets, Greasy Love Songs. We had Crux of the Biscuit with Apostrophe. We had Meat Light with Uncle Meat. And the second one was this, Lumpy Money, which of course looks at Lumpy Gravy and We're Only in It for the Money. And each of the 3 CDs is set up almost identical in that each of the 3 CDs is a Lumpy Money experience. Roughly the first, not half because it's a little bit shorter, but roughly the first half of each CD is dedicated to Lumpy Gravy, essentially three different versions of what Lumpy Gravy could be. And then the second half of each CD is We're Only in It for the Money tracks. You get a mono mix, a 1968 mono mix, which I think this is the first time this mix has been released. You get the horrible, which I did not like at the time, 84 Utility Muffin Research Kitchen mix, which added Wackerman and Barrow on drums and bass respectively. That was the only thing you could buy for a while on CD, then that was pulled. And then, so you can't buy it anymore, but now you can get it here. So something that nobody wanted when it came out is now something that you can only get here, and kind of makes it valuable in a weird way. And then the third, and then there's also just random like backing tracks and stuff like that, which I think reconvinced me how incredibly complex and strong and wonderful the music is without the words. You add the words and you have a genius album. But I will say this, if you're not a fan of Lumpy Gravy, and really, to me, this is a Lumpy Gravy release. What makes this so incredibly special are the Lumpy Gravy tracks that are on here. The We're Only in It for the Money stuff is great, but you're not getting drastic reissues or drastic versions of We're Only in It for the Money. You're just getting some slightly different versions, plus the basic tracks and all that. It's the Lumpy Gravy stuff on here that is incredible. So let's just attack that first. So the first CD, the Lumpy Gravy thing, is called Lumpy Gravy Primordial. And all this is the music that was recorded before the piano people came in, before Frank, as he says in an interview on the third disc, before he just randomly cut it up into little segments and then randomly taped it together to see what would happen. This is 9 different parts that comprise, that would eventually go on to comprise the music of that. And in these nine parts, you get all of those other musical things that would pop up in Love Be Gravy. You get Oh No, you get Pound for a Brown, you get the Run Home music, you get World's Greatest Sinner. You don't get the King Kong. I don't think King Kong pops up in here at all. So you get all of these different parts that would eventually go on to be part of Love Be Gravy. They're all about 3 minutes long, 2 to 3 minutes long. The whole thing all together is only about 22 minutes. So we're talking like a third, maybe a third of the CD. But it's really interesting to listen to. It is incredible music. You can hear a lot of different things, you know, obviously, that would pop up in Love Be Gravy. Some of the stuff would pop up on We're Only In It for the Money as sort of those little musical interludes. And so to hear it all in its original context is just phenomenal. And then I also think it adds to the, once you then, if you're familiar with Lumpy Gravy and you know where the voices come in and the talking comes in and where the edits come in, to hear this without the edits and expect the edits to come in, you just kind of get a whole different sense of the, how impressive Lumpy Gravy is as an album. So that's what you get on the first disc, the Primordial. The second disc, you get a version of Lumpy Gravy that was mixed back in 84 when Frank did the mixing for We're Only In It for the Money. So on this mix, you have Chad Wackerman drums, not in the entire thing. You have Barrow doing some bass. You get Ike Willis doing some character from an album I'm not going to name. You get Ray White doing vocals. And this is the thing that inspired me to want, not inspire me, but gave me the idea that Lumpy Gravy should be offered to the masses. Because there are sections in here in which you have the old Lumpy Gravy music and Frank has overdubbed either Ike Willis and Ray White singing duah-da-num, duah-da-num, duah-duah, duah-duah-da-num, singing the Lumpy Gravy theme, which is called duah-da-num. He even throws in a mammy nun, so getting a little too close to that. Complete sidetrack right here. If someone were to take, I can see a world where my least favorite album of Frank's all time is this one right here. I don't even say the name of it because I dislike it so much. It's that one. But hearing Ike Willis sing Mammy Nuns as the Lumpy Gravy theme, I can see a world where this, I almost said the title, is Lumpy Gravy Phase 3 and Civilization becomes Phase 4. I can see where you take this concept and you put it with the Piano People and you put a little more level of surrealism in it and you throw in the random sort of Lumpy Gravy aesthetic of cutting random slices of tape together and seeing what happens. I can see that working for that. And what made that work here is this disc two, the version, that 1984 version of Lumpy Gravy, where you get music that obviously sounds disconnected from the original music. Like, we're not at that age digitally where they can match the atmospheres. So there are certain parts of this where Frank has replaced whatever music was originally there and put drums and bass from Wackerman and Barrow behind it. He has some talking, some singing from Ike and Ray. And so it is a really weird disconnect in, sorry if I'm getting confused here, but it is a very strange disconnect. Like, on We're Only In It for the Money, the Wackerman and Barrow tracks just didn't work. To me, they stood out. It was a bad decision. Here, it works geniusly. It makes it, it gives it a whole new feel, a whole new vibe. Like, Lumpy Gravy is a piece of work that is like Lumpy Gravy, and what you do with it can be a whole bunch of different things. And the idea that other people could take like the basic tracks that consist of the original Lumpy Gravy, and they could add their own dynamics and their own voices and their own thing, to me opens up just possibilities galore with this music. This should be Frank's open source project. Let everybody have a shot to do something with Lumpy Gravy. I think it would be phenomenal. And Frank's own working on that on the second disc, where it's pretty much Lumpy Gravy as we know it, with all of these different sort of 84 components added in. Just love it. It's phenomenal. Surprisingly, it's one of my favorite things on this release. But it is a whole new different way to listen to Lumpy Gravy. I'm glad they didn't release it. I think I probably would have not liked it as much had they released it back when they released the original Lumpy Gravy on CD. If they had used this, I would have probably been upset. But now that I have both, I am not. And then on the third disc, this is probably the money shot right here. The first thing on disc three is something called How Did That Get In Here? And this is a 25-minute bulk of material, a lot of it, couple really long, nice jam segments. You can tell there's some editing going on in here. This was recorded Sunday, February 13th, 1967. And this is, there's some straight up jams in here. There's some jazz jams. There's a moment where it sounds like a Doors sort of Light My Fire jam. There's different parts that you would definitely recognize that would go into Lumpy Gravy, the intro, then King Kong pops up, or maybe Oh No pops up. But then there are just some really amazing just moments where the band is just jamming away, and it's got sort of a bluesy, definitely like a 10 years after Canned Heat vibe at some point. Some point it becomes more chaotically jazz. At some point it becomes more Frank conducting Random Noises. But there's all of these little like 3 to 4 minute segments, and this goes on for 25 minutes. And this is just a revelation. This is just such an amazing listen. It was the thing that ultimately like compelled this album for me all the way up to the top 10 was this track, because I never knew it existed before. When it came out, it was just, a phenomenal piece of like how Frank would take this, and then eventually, again, it would turn into Lumpy Gravy. So there, just love it. And then after that, you get a bunch of Lumpy Gravy stuff, some other music, and I think an interview, and some, you know, outtakes of talking and stuff like that. That fills up the rest of Lumpy Gravy's portion of disc three. So the Lumpy Gravy stuff is the stuff that propelled this into the top 10 for me, because each one of the Lumpy Gravy releases is a little bit different and offers a different take on it, but doesn't actually give you, I think, what most of us know as Lumpy Gravy. And then the We're Only In It for the Money Haves, that was my second favorite album of all time. It's also, you know, my favorite album of all time, depending on the mood. What you get on there is you get a mono mix, the original 1968 mono mix that I don't think was ever released. So this is not the same one that Frank released, but it was a different mix. So you get that. Again, the music is still the same, so there's not much change there. On the second disc, you get that horrible 1984 remix, or I guess it was released in 86, remixed in 84. It's no longer available on CD. Nobody liked it when it came out and people complained, but now going back and listening to it, it's interesting, and I'm glad. Well, I have it twice now, but it's interesting. But again, it was a mistake at the time to replace the tracks, and apparently they didn't need to be replaced because we have versions of them where they're not replaced. And then that's disc two. And then the end of disc three, it's all backing tracks and basic tracks and, all the stuff that is on We're Only In It for the Money, but instrumental versions. You can argue that this album didn't even need words and that it could have been an instrumental and it would have still worked. That's how great the music is on here. You do get the single version of Lonely Little Girl. You get some different stuff, but mostly it's just interviews and instrumental takes of We're Only In It for the Money stuff, which you kind of got to be really hardcore about that album to enjoy it, but I am hardcore about that album, so I enjoy it. But anyways, yeah, so that's number nine, Lumpy Money. I went back and forth a long time between this and number eight, because they both, well, you'll see when I get to number eight, because number eight is still an album that's very much in flux. But this one, this is just, it's the Lumpy Gravy stuff on here is so good. And I really do think that like ZFT should open source the basic tracks for Lumpy Gravy and encourage people to produce it and do their own things with it and have a whole Lumpy Gravy series of stuff from different artists and producers and magicians. We want magic to happen. I think it would be phenomenal. But that's it. That's all I got to say for now. Let me know if you have this, what you think of it. Let me know what you think of it. Again, I think it is more for the hardcore fan than it is for the casual fan. But if you are a hardcore fan, it's really, really, really has some great payoff in it. And that's it. I'm done. It's hot here in Texas. I have to do this like super early in the morning. Otherwise, it's just like sweat. All right. That's it. Peace, y'all. Take care. I'm out. Thanks for watching. Subscribe. All that stuff.